Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. So guys, are you ready to cover the current affairs for today? On that note, let's begin today's current affairs. But before that, if you have not subscribed to our channel, then do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification. Also guys, you can join this Telegram group where we provide you with the free quizzes as well as latest updates about the examination. And this is the new course for RBI Grade B 2022. Here you will get PDFs, videos and mocks along with the interview preparation. So we conduct mock interviews as well for your preparation. And this is the booklet that you will get if you enroll in our course. And this booklet includes all the books mentioned right in front of you. Right now we are running a 30% discount on the course. So if you are willing to avail that discount, you have to use RBI 30 coupon code. And this is the number which you can dial if you have any problems regarding the course or about the examination. So that was the introduction. Now let's begin with our first question. The surplus transfer by RBI to central government in FY21 is equivalent to dash percent of GDP as per RBI's state of economy report. So guys, this report has been released by RBI very recently, and according to this report, the surplus that RBI transferred to the central government accounts for, or we can say the amount that was transferred by RBI to the central government, that amount is equivalent to 0.44% of GDP. So if we calculate the amount that was transferred by RBI to the central government in the year 2020 to 2021, that is FY21, that amount as a ratio of GDP is equal to this percentage, 0.44%. Now what was the amount in actual terms? In actual terms, the amount was ₹99,122 crores. Now guys, if we compare this transfer, this amount, this percentage has increased from the amount that was transferred in 2019 to 2020. So in 2019 to 2020, the amount that was transferred was 57,128 crores, which was 0.29% of the GDP. So this percentage has increased to 0.44% in the year 2020 to 2021. Now guys, you have to tell that which committee suggested this distribution of surplus by RBI to the central government. You have to name that committee in the comment section below. Now, as far as this transfer is concerned, then you should know this thing, that in terms of transferring the surplus of central bank to the central government, Turkey stands at the first position and India is at the second position with 0.44% of its GDP being transferred to the central government. Not the GDP, but the amount that is equivalent to this percentage of GDP is being transferred from the central bank to the central government. Now let us understand this report in detail. Now guys, for better understanding, I have divided this report in three segments. The first segment talks about the surplus transfer. The second segment talks about the foreign exchange reserves. And the third segment talks about the other facts related to the COVID-19. So the way COVID-19 has impacted the economy, that is something that is discussed in the third part of this report. So now let us understand what this report tells us about the surplus transfer from the central bank to the central government. As I have already told you, that India stands at the second position in comparison to Turkey when we compare the transfer of reserves from the central bank to the central government. Now you would better understand it from this picture, because it is going to help you in memorizing the facts better. Okay, so 0.44% of GDP or transfer of surplus from central bank to the central government as percentage of GDP is something that has been measured through this chart. 0.44% of GDP is the India's percentage. Okay, now this is the data for FY20 and this is the data for FY21. So clearly here you can see India's position is at the fourth rank. Okay, with 0.9% of amount of 0.9% of GDP equivalent amount being transferred by the central government to the central government, central bank to the central government. Now this amount has increased, this percentage and the rank has increased to 0.44 and second position respectively. So the rank is second position and the percentage has increased to 0.44%. And Turkey is at the first position, Malaysia is at the third position, Sweden, and then we have Kenya. So this much amount is being transferred by the central government, by the central bank to the central government. Now let us understand the other facts provided by this report. So these are the amounts that we have already discussed. Now here, this point is important. According to the report, seigniorage between 0.5% and 1% of GDP allows the central bank to conduct monetary policy with a fair degree of independence. Coinage is a term used to describe profits the government makes by printing currency. So I hope this term is clear to you. Guys, you have to memorize this term because this term is very important and it can be asked from you in your examination. Okay, now, coinage between 0.5% to 1% of GDP allows the central bank to conduct the monetary policy with a fair degree of independence. So we have already known what this coinage means, that is to make money or make profit by printing the currency. Since RBI has transferred this much percentage, 0.44%, to the central government already, so there are apprehensions that this might impact the working of monetary policy. So you would already know this fact that there are two types of policy that drive the economy. First is fiscal, that is completely in the hands of central government, and second is monetary policy, that is completely in the hands of the Central Bank of India, that is RBI. So in order to ensure that monetary policy works independently, the coinage needs to be kept between 0.5% to 1%. And here RBI is saying that we haven't reached even 0.5% of the level, so we are in the safe zone. So that is the point that RBI is making in this report. I hope that this is clear to you guys. Now let's move on to the second segment of this report that talks about the foreign exchange reserves. Why is this segment important? Because you must have heard about the news that India has become the fifth largest foreign reserve holding country with $600 billion of foreign exchange reserves. Now guys, this report is making the point that this foreign exchange reserve position can be deceptive. So the people who are thinking that this foreign exchange reserve has made India's position sound and robust, so they might be in a little bit of misunderstanding, because this position, this foreign exchange reserves of India, can provide cover for less than 15 months against the projected imports for 2021 to 2022. Now, what does this mean? This means that whenever the central government or the country imports, there is an assurance in exchange of that imports, and that assurance or that insurance is in the form of foreign exchange reserves. So the reserves that we have provide guarantee for the less than 15 months of imports for the upcoming year 2021 to 2022. Which is lower than other major reserve holding countries, which are Switzerland, Japan, Russia and China. Therefore, the report highlights that India's foreign exchange reserve position can be deceptive. Another reason why India's forex reserve position is deceptive is that India is a major FDI recipient and India's net international investment position is -12.9% of GDP. Now guys, here we can use the data of World Investment Report that was recently released by UNCTAD. So if you remember, there UNCTAD highlighted that India received 64 billion FDI inflows, whereas the FDI outflows was just 12 billion. So the net investment position, that is the difference between the outflows and the inflows, is -12.9% of GDP. So this indicates that the moment these investors suck out their money from the Indian economy, the foreign exchange reserves will run dry. That is why this forex reserve position is deceptive. Okay, this month the level of foreign exchange reserve crossed the $600 billion mark, because actually in actual terms we have $605 billion as forex reserve. Now this makes India the fifth largest reserve holding country, 12th largest foreign holder of US treasury securities, and 10th largest in terms of gold reserves. So that was all about the foreign exchange reserves that this report has told us. Now the next thing here is the impact of second wave of COVID on the Indian economy. So this second wave can cause a loss of 2 trillion from FY22 output. So the output, the entire GDP in the year FY22 can be hit by 2 trillion rupees due to the second wave of COVID-19. And other economic indicators such as GST collection was good, and GST collection in May was around 1 lakh crores, which was 65% higher than that in the same month last year. Now guys, this data is clearly for reference. You don't have to memorize this data about GST. So that was all about this report. I hope that you have understood this report well, and if you have any query related to the report, then you can ask me on the Telegram group as well. Now let's discuss the second question. How many integrated theater commands are operating in India at present? 5, 2, 3, 0, 1. So out of these options, the right answer is 2. The people who would know what is this integrated theater command would have answered it as 1. But right now, it's not the one. There are two integrated theater commands that are operating in India. One is Andaman and Nicobar command, and second one is Strategic Forces command. Now, why is this question here and what is the integrated theater command for those who don't know about it? Now, I'm going to discuss all these things in detail. So the first fact, why are we discussing about the integrated theater commands right now? The reason behind this, a new committee has been formed by the central government that includes the vice chiefs of the three armed forces, Army, Navy and Air Force, the chief of integrated defense staff to the chairman chiefs of staff committee and representatives from the ministries of Home Affairs, Finance and Law. Now, why has this committee been formed by the government? The purpose is to examine the feasibility of creating integrated tri-services theater commands and give recommendation on the same, and these recommendations will be submitted to the Cabinet Committee on Security later on. Now, at present, there are only two tri-services commands in India, Strategic Forces Command that handles the entire nuclear assets in India, and second one is Andaman and Nicobar Island Command. Guys, last year, this Andaman and Nicobar Island Command conducted an exercise. You have to name that exercise. Okay, so that was about the current news. Now let's discuss what this integrated theater command is, because this is the biggest ever reformed in the structure of armed forces in India. So if this integrated theater command is created, then it would be the larger than the life reform in the Indian armed forces. What is an integrated tri-services theater command? Integrated, we all know what does integrate mean. Tri-services here, Air Force, Navy and Army. Theater command. Now what is the meaning of this? It is basically going to be an organization under which all three Army, Navy and Air Force operate on the command of one theater commander. For example, let me give you an example. This is the map of India. Forget about the things mentioned on this map. Just pay focus on what I am telling you. Under this integrated theater command, basically there would be five commands that will be created. Right now you can see that there are different commands here. Okay, a total of 17 commands exist in India at present. Now you have Army, Air Force and Navy command. But after this integrated theater command comes into implementation, comes into being, then these commands will be collaborated. These commands will be integrated. So there would be five commands. First would be for handling the Chinese border. So this would be the first command, the North China specific Northern Command. Second command would focus on Pakistan border. So this would be the Pakistan specific Western Command. Third command would deal with the peninsular region. So this would be the peninsular command. Then we will have Air Defense Command and Maritime Command. Under these commands, all the operations of Air Force, Navy and Army will be synchronized, and there would be only one commander that will be handling or giving orders to all these three services. So it will serve two purposes. First is to avoid the duplication, wastage of resources, and second is to avoid the delay in executing the orders, in giving and executing the orders, and it will effectively implement the army strategies and achieve victories in cases of wars. So that is the purpose of creating these integrated theater commands. Okay, now coming back to the slide, so we already have discussed the purposes, that is to reduce delay in the times of warfare and increase efficiency of armed forces. Integration and jointness will avoid duplication of resources. Then all the resources from Army, Navy and Air Force will be at the disposal of the commander of one theater command. So all the regional resources provided to the Army, Navy and the Air Force will be at the helm of this regional command or the theater command. The integrated theater commander will not be answerable to individual forces, because he is going to be at the upper level of these three individual forces. And remember, the modus operandi of these theater commands will be based on area. So as we have already discussed, that this would be focusing on the China specific border, so it will not interfere with the Western specific command, with the Pakistan specific Western command. It will not meddle with the operations of this command or with this command or with any other two commands, maritime or air defense. Okay, it will handle its operation. Here, so that is the purpose, that is the meaning of having the modus operandi on the basis of area. Now let us know something more about the theater command. So as I have already told you that it is going to be the biggest reform in the Indian Army structure, Sheikh Khatkar Committee in 2015 recommended the creation of three integrated theater commands, the northern for China border, western for Pakistan and southern for maritime role for peninsular region. In October 2020, the central government announced to create five integrated theater commands, China-specific northern command, Pakistan-specific western command, peninsular theater command, air defense command, and maritime theater command by the year 2022. So that was the target announced by the central government. Now this China-specific northern command will handle the entire area from Kokoram Pass in Ladakh to the Kibitu in Arunachal Pradesh. So these are the two border notches from the starting to the end, from Ladakh to Arunachal Pradesh, and that would be the entire operational area for this northern command. Headquarters of this command can be Lucknow. Guys, this is expected. Since this command has not been created yet, therefore we cannot say what is the headquarters. Remember, it is just expected. Next is Pakistan specific Western Command. So it will undertake all the defense related activities along the Indo-Pakistan border from the Santoro Bridge in Siachen Glacier to Gujarat, to the tip of Gujarat. And its expected headquarters is likely to be in Jaipur. Again, expected, it's not confirmed. Peninsular Command will handle the operations related to the peninsular region. Air Defense Command will protect and defend the entire airspace of India. Maritime Theater Command will protect and defend the entire maritime space of Indian Ocean region and island territories of India, because this is very important because of the increasing intrusion of China in the Indian Ocean region. Therefore, it is very important to have an integrated theater command that can reduce the time taken in making decisions and taking action. Okay, now there is one more fact related to this maritime theater command, and that is that resources from Indian Coast Guard will also be merged with this maritime theater command. So Indian Navy, Indian Coast Guard and Army Air Force, so all these armed forces will be merged into this maritime theater command. Then we have Andaman and Nicobar Island Command, which is the only integrated theater command apart from the Strategic Force Command in India. So this is going to be merged with this maritime theater command. So that is all about this integrated theater commands that are going to be created by the central government in order to strengthen the armed forces in it. So I hope that you have understood it well. Now let's discuss the third question. With which European country has India formed a trilateral partnership to create stability in the Indo-Pacific region along with Japan? Germany, Belgium, Spain, UK, Italy are in the options. The right answer is Italy. Now this is the second time India has joined forces with a European country to bring stability in the Indo-Pacific region. Earlier, India, France and Australia were the three countries that formed the trilateral partnership to create stability in the Indo-Pacific region. Now, the purpose is very clear, that is to bring stability and establish a rule-based international order in the region. And this is particularly to counter China. Then we have the next point, as that this is the second trilateral partnership involving India and a European country. The first one was India, France and Australia. Italy currently holds the presidency of G20 in 2021. Now guys, can you tell me that when will India hold the presidency of G20? This is your question. Now India's other trilateral partnerships for cooperation in the Indo-Pacific region are these many. So with these many countries, India has formed trilateral partnerships just to protect the Indo-Pacific region. So that was all about this question. Now I'm moving on to the next question. With which country has India signed an MOU for cooperation in the field of agriculture and allied sectors? So it is Fiji. Now what are the areas where the cooperation will take place? So these are the areas: dairy, rice, food crop diversification, water resources management, etc. etc. You would be thinking that are you supposed to learn all these areas of cooperation? No. Particularly the students who are appearing for RBI-SEBI, guys, you won't have to memorize all these areas of cooperation, because directly these areas cannot be asked from you in your examination. But the NABARD students, now the question is for you guys. Do you have to remember all these areas of cooperation? No. The answer here is no, because again, in NABARD also, the test is for analyzing the students' capabilities, not to murder them. Therefore, again, you are also exempted from memorizing all these areas of cooperation. Now, moving on further into this news. So, under this MOU, a joint working group will also be established that will conduct meetings alternatively in India and Fiji once every 2 years. And the purpose of that meeting would be to recommend programs for cooperation towards achieving the aims. And this MOU will be in place for 5 years. So these were the minor facts related to this MOU. What is the GDP forecast for India for FY 2021 by Moody? So out of these options, the right answer is 9.6%. Now, earlier the forecast was 13.9%, but this has been reduced to 9.6%. For the calendar year 2022, the forecast is 7%. Now guys, remember that it is for the calendar year 2021. Moody's releases the GDP forecast for calendar year as well as financial year. So whenever it is written calendar year, you have to focus on it. Okay. So this forecast is for calendar year 2021. For calendar year 2022, the forecast is 7%. Okay. So that was all for today, guys. I hope that you have learned something in this video. Thank you so much for watching the video.